live stream of the audio was Lola.
Yeah,
So welcome everybody to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY. My name is Frank Henschke, and I'm the director of the Siegel Center, and I put this together with Antje Oegel and the friends, our friends from the Gorky Theater. Many of them had to leave yesterday because already they took out a week of their life, which is a lot in Berlin terms. And but we have with us here Dimitri, who was here on Monday night in the evening, and for Yael's play, Walk on the Dark Side before, and he also was part of the play, which we will hear now, and co-created it, so we will have a discussion with him after the work here. He's one of the great, most recognizable actors at the Gorky and a staple in the Berlin theater scene, so thank you for staying with us and being with us. A few words about the Penn World Voices Festival. It is the most significant literary festival in North America, perhaps in the Americas. It was created by Esther Allen, Salman Rushdie, and Michael Roberts. And they at the time really thought, when George Bush Jr. came to the White House, that the tunnel vision of the Americans would only get longer and darker, and that not enough voices from the outside are being heard. 95% of all books printed are in the English language come from America or the Britain. The other half of the 5%, maybe French and German, because there are lots of help to publicize books. So whereas one or two books from the other 100 or 200 nations, and this is, of course, scandalous and wrong, and as I always say, any musician, self-respecting musician, listens to music from all around the world, and it's vitally important to hear what his colleagues and people are doing, and to be inspired, and also to inspire others, and I think we all have to work harder to make that happen around the world, and in America especially. I think it's such a big island, of course, but still it is an island, and we should all have to try harder. And I think this festival, especially from the outreach also Chip Rowley did this year, the festival curator, is one more step into that direction, and we are truly honored as a Siegel Center. Our small center here is part of it. We've been with them for over 10 years and presented many, many place. Normally, we always have them from different continents, different countries, from Australia, Africa, North Africa, Arab world, India, the Caribbean. We really support minority languages, but this time we really thought we highlight the Gorky Theater. Monday evening, we had a great talk about the mission, the work of the Gorky, which was taken over in 2015 by Sherman Langhoff and Jens Hilge, and their idea was, let's just get everybody who is a migrant or identifies, whether they came for work or they had to leave, whether they were refugees or they are first-generation immigrants, let's give them a theater. Let's not write plays about them by clever people, but let's give them the space. They create the work. They developed a new collaborative way to create plays with sensational results. Everybody thought, oh my God, no one's going to see all the problem plays. Who wants to do that? But it was truly a lot of energy is coming out of that space, a real working, as I said, a place. It's wonderful to see when theaters are like this, and it's a shining example of what a theater can do in a city, what a place can be. And on the way, they also discovered a way of collaborating, of writing in a way, as Brecht has said, we need new forms of theater for the new times we live in. And they found new works, new ways of writing and creating plays in ensembles, around the table, focusing on a theme, not having a playwright, changing up to the day of the opening what is in and out. Actors like Dimitri say, I don't like these lines, I'm not going to speak those from the writer, but I have a monologue idea. And they say, okay, fine, let's try it out. We don't think it's work, but why not? But then it does work. So it sounds all a bit casual, but it's a traumatic change also for German theater that this is on a main stage, what normally is done by groups. New York downtown groups, of course, work that way for a very long time, create writing in that way. But to have it in a big theater is as unusual as it would be in the Broadway show here when someone said, oh, let's change the opening scene or the end scene the day before, or maybe the musical that the singer said, I'm going to write my own song, I don't want to sing this song. It's unthinkable, and as it was before. So they really changed. And now in all theaters in Germany, and now we need to have the people whose voices we hear on the street, in their dialect, in their kind of accents, are represented on stage. So lots of actors come from Russia or Israel or from Syria, and then you will hear how they speak, as they do in real life. So it's quite a fantastic concept, and We had here Yael Ronan, Sivian Ben Yeshai, Nora Abdel Masood, Falk Richter last night, and today we have Necati, Öziri, and then Sibylle Berg, so two more. And these works, the six works we present here, are representative for all the other works, of course, too, but they're also a great selection, and to really get an insight about that unique work of the Gorky. The Siegel Center, British Academia and Professional Theater, International and American Theater, and of course, this is right at the center. And then here with us is Ashley Kelly Tata. Here's the director who put the reading together. You want to say a few words, or should we start right away? We should start. I already spoke way too long. That means what she says. And she is right. Now it's time. Take out your cell phone, please, and see if a ringer is off, and I'll do the same. Is it off? Yeah. Okay, now get Deutsch or Die Tryin, and by Necati Öziri. Thank you.
This great country, about my friends, about May Days at the Central Station, about our last summer. You're sitting on your bench, and you nod to a few people. You know him. You know him. You know him too. Him too. And him. Know them well enough to see that not friends, but brothers. They'd snitch on you if they had to, and you'd snitch on them if you had to.
Arda, come on.
You sit on your bench 4, 5, maybe 6 hours. The station clock is smashed. Someone smashed it with a baseball bat. You know who, and you'd tell if you got asked. One bench further on, the goblets are jerking around on pills. Air Max, Lonsdale jacket, pit bull, monkey. Monkey has a can in one hand and his dick in the other. Beef and neck are dancing their weird heel dance. March on the spot, shuffle to the right, shake your skin head. Shuffle to the left, march on the spot, shake your skin head. They're not Nazis, not real ones anyways. They buy from you and you buy from them. Two benches further up, the Russians. Well, Russian Germans, really. Immigrants. Kazakhs. Uzbeks. Polacks. Refugees. Never on the bench, but always squatting in front of it. But they don't buy anything. They just drink. Enough bottles for everyone. In the bags, under the bench. But they prefer to all share one at a time. That's communist for you.
Arda, what's up? Are you in?
Guys, leave that shit. If the cops come.
Shit, boy, you being pussy?
You're sitting on your bench 4, 5, maybe 6 summers already. Danny's with you, and you sit on your bench. Boyan is with you, you sit on your bench. Savas is with you, you're at home. You're wearing your crescent moon outside your shirt today, and you stroke your mustache. And since 9/11, no one thinks it's cool anymore.
Girl! Hey, girl, nice hoops!
It's a Friday night. Your brain is as sloppy as your walk.
What'd you say, asshole?
You're 18, nearly, and your blood is boiling.
Delicado.
You're 18, nearly, and the world belongs to you.
Fuck, you punched him.
Savas punched him!
That fucking asshole. Arda, did you see that?
Come on, let's get out of here.
Tomorrow's your birthday, and this is probably your last summer together.
Girl. Hey, girl, nice hoops. Baby, what's up with you tonight?
Danny loves women.
Come on over here, sugar.
Every single one.
We're about to have a birthday party and we still need some cream.
He just appreciates everything about them.
Hey, you. Gorgeous eyes.
But especially...
Here she comes, behave. You, behave yourselves, you monkeys. Hi. Hey. Check that out. There is a god. Hi. Hey.
But Danny especially loves...
She's not even looking over. Who does that bitch think she is? That's right. Keep walking, you cunt. Who do you think you are? Fuck, I just love her, bro.
But Danny especially loves Susanna.
So bad.
So Susanna.
Her so bad.
Susanna. Never Suzanne. Never call her Suzanne. There's a legend about that, right? A guy right in the middle of it.
Oh, shit, Suzanne! You're the best!
She pulls his head back. She sticks her chewing gum between the hair and his balls in his ass and stubs her cigarette out on his forehead. She gets dressed, and she leaves.
Fuck. She's just got it.
So, Suzanne, you've told him plenty of times. Believe me. Leave it. You said, stay away from her. 1.6 meters. 53 kilograms of pure walnut baklava and hot pants and a top. She comes and flowers shoot up out of the field where the bums hang out. She comes and the goblins start dancing ballet and the pit bulls howl at the moon. She comes and the station smells like vanilla. Her tits are too big for her age because of the pill. Glitter sparkles on her cleavage in red and white, the colors of the Polish flag. So Susanna, the reason Danny hangs out in front of the church every Sunday, father, 48,3000 city taxi. Two brothers, 48,3000 city taxi.
She has to make it.
When her school counselor fails her, she says,
Mr. Headmaster, sir, he made a perverted offer.
She has to make it.
She will make it.
So Susanna, you've told him plenty of times, believe me, leave it, you said, stay away from her. But Danny loves women, especially the ones who are no good for him.
He got that from his mom.
Daniello!
Danny actually isn't a spaghettino. His mom is just really into Eros Ramazzotti, grappa, sunbed, brown skin. Danny sits in front of the PlayStation, his grasp drawing behind it at the console's fan.
Daniello, are you there?
Hello!
Danny, sweetie, can I come in for a minute?
What are you doing here?
What do you mean?
Weren't you...
I'm better already.
The fuck you are?
Daniel, how can you talk to me like this?
What do you want?
I want to introduce you to Robert. This is Robert.
Ah, I'm Rob.
You can call him Roberto, too.
Hi, Robert.
Nice room.
Go fuck yourself, Robert.
Listen, you little shit, you're gonna say hello properly now.
I just did. Hello, Robert.
Roberto is going to be around more from now on.
Cool.
Me and your mother... We met recently in the...
Good for you! Now fuck off!
Since Danny's father came home...
They closed the mine.
And then disappeared.
Danny, look. This is Mike. Oh, yes. This is Mike. Danny, look. This here is Thomas. Here we have him. Yes. Thomas. This is Robert. Where is Robert? Ah! Here we have him! Robert. This is Robert. Give me Robert. Give me Robert. That's my Robert.
Later, Danny had thousands of fathers. One for each cold turkey. So, Susanna.
Hey, Susanna. Say hi to your brother for me.
You've told him plenty of times.
He's sitting two benches down. Say hi to him yourself.
Believe me, you said.
Did you hear that? She's definitely into me.
Stay away from her. Then, backseat action. One whole summer long, Danny has his hand in Susanna's pants. Beside you and me on the bench.
Punch me.
Ha!
Harder.
3 months later, you see the two of them near the McDonald's on the way into the bum field.
Punch me.
Ha!
Harder.
And you get it. Her tits weren't just bigger because of the pill.
Punch me.
Ha!
Harder.
You know she has two Polish brothers and Mary didn't know where Jesus came from anyways.
Harder.
Ha!
You know he really fucking loves the smell of vanilla.
Harder.
You notice his fist slows down right at her belly.
Harder. Fuck's sake, that won't do anything.
You know he actually wants to keep it.
Harder.
I can't!
Hit me harder, Danny, please.
And Susanna pukes her Big Mac up. A gust of wind blows through the corridor, scatters Danny around the station, and Susanna's brothers pick him up.
His name is Damien now. He celebrates Christmas in church now. He left school and he's training to be a roof tiler. They called it Tamash. Roof tiling sucked. Now he's a tattoo artist. Tattoo artist sucked. He's doing a 1 euro job now. Her father got him a job in Warsaw.
Wait. Go back. Let's start again from the top.
Hey, Arda, listen, tell Mom to finally transfer me my fucking children's allowance. That's my fucking money, mine. She can drink all her money if she wants or whatever, but that's my money. I'm entitled to it. If she can't get her shit together, fuck, for a year I've been saying, if she can't get her shit together, then she should set up a fucking transfer order. It can't be that hard. Same shit every month. Or she should just give me my account at the welfare office, but it's my money. Sorry that you're always stuck in the middle. How are you? How's school? I'm fine. Family here are a bit of a drag. Pretty nice, actually, but a bit boring. They leave the radio on all day. The tablecloth is yellow, and everyone has their own plate for their eggs with their own name on it. You can imagine them all eating their eggs off them every morning. I don't know how much more I can stand it. Listen, I'll be in town this weekend. Maybe we can hang out for a bit if you feel like it. Oh, shit. I almost forgot. Happy birthday, bro. Fuck. 18. Crazy. I love you so much. You're probably out with the guys. Take care of yourself. Hopefully I'll see you soon. Call me.
Fuck, he punched him.
That asshole Savas punched him!
Arda, come on, let's get out of here.
You start running. You start running down the station, under the underpass, out into the bump field, along Bismarck Street, you lose your smokes. You start running. You're standing there in the queue. All around you, nothing but baseball caps and coconut wax. You can feel the bass from inside the place, and you try to keep your head down as long as possible. To look down, to hide from the blue Nike cap in front of you, your grass in your sock, you're standing there in the queue.
I'm going for a piss.
You go first.
Arda goes first.
It's always like that. You're old enough. Well, nearly. But you don't have any ID. No, not with you. You don't have one because you never did. Because...
Don't ask about shit like that.
You don't have any ID.
Just act like you're normal, okay?
You go first, and if you don't get in, none of you are gone. You're standing in the queue. Someone behind you taps you on the shoulder. A scar above his eyebrow, gray liver spots on his cheek, maybe Turkish, not German anyway.
Is that little Hugo with you?
That little Hugo is with you.
He's just gone for a piss.
But in the wrong corner.
You start running. You start running out of the queue behind the building.
Get out of here, fuck off.
And you only get it later that was real high vine. It's really dumb. Guys appear from the bushes like they're going after the lamps.
Wallet's out.
Scar above his eyebrow, gray liver spots on his left cheek, butterfly in his right hand. Danny gets hit.
Wallet's out. Jacket's off, too.
You take off your jackets.
Is that a real jersey?
No. It's from the bazaar in Bodrum.
Take it off anyway.
You put your jacket on the ground and you pull your socks up a little higher. You hide your crescent moon under your shirt. Then you get hit.
Give me that chain. Give me the chain now.
Hand on the crescent moon, you look at Boyan. His eyes
looking down at the ground.
His mother's recipe for survival.
Give me that chain.
You look at Danny in his undershirt. His eyes.
Forget it, it's no use.
Give me that chain.
You look at Savas. His eyes.
I'm with you.
But you count six guys. That's too many. And you.
Where are you from?
Normally when someone says that, you say,
Your mom.
If a German asks you,
you hit them.
If a butterfly asks,
from Konya.
You never would have said that yourself.
Who was talking to you?
We both come from there.
ID.
You don't have any ID.
Not with you?
You don't have any ID.
So never had one. Where exactly in Konya?
My father and his know each other from Karaman.
Yes, Dunyai Gor Konyai, yeah? And you don't have any ID.
You're not.
They were at the protests.
You get a punch. And then you're stuck. And then your stuff is five again. You're three. Look at you. At him. At you.
You can keep your chain. The stuff in your socks, too.
Happy birthday.
But the money stays with me.
You're not.
Ben de Konyaliyim. Tuz Gulden. Kurdistan was once on my ID.
You're not.
We've at least got to stick together here, right?
You're not.
Say hi to your dad from me.
You'd like to take off your chain and strangle him and stuff it into his mouth before you send his coffin into the Konya salt desert, but you're not.
No police or any shit like that.
You start running. You start running back to the club, past the queue. The blue Nike cap come towards you.
The guy on the door is a Turk too.
You keep running. It's past 12. You keep running. What you don't know yet tonight, in 4 months, you'll get a letter. It'll be lying there on the coffee table, between beer-stained little brochures and credit checks, a court summons for you. Your mom will ask you,
what have you done now?
Tell her quickly.
You didn't get that from me.
And then go sleep. You wait outside the courtroom, the summons in your hand, across from his mother, and praying, she's praying and begging for you.
Don't testify, please, don't testify. You're the last man I have.
Sabas comes towards you, winks at you, and you go into the courtroom, scar above his eyebrow, tears on his cheek, class action, armed robbery, multiple charges, hands folded, his suit jacket too big, Danny's Germany jersey underneath it.
And how much money did you have in your wallet that night, Mr. Yilmaz?
You say double the amount that was actually in it. You think, yes, good, Dunyayi, good, Konyayi.
You're eight, and you have no clue about the world. You come home, you throw your bag down in the kitchen. Your mother's dozing on the couch. On the floor in front of her, two bottles of Yeltsin vodka, empty. The TV's too loud. Columbo is questioning a suspect without the suspect realizing. Wait. Again. You come home. You're eight. You throw your bag down in the kitchen. Your mother on the couch, the Yeltsin bottles in front of it, Columbo's questioning a suspect. Suddenly, a car explodes. Your mother jumps. The bottles clatter. Columbo saves himself behind the truck.
Out! Everybody out! Arda, quickly!
Now, again. You're eight. You come home. Bag in the kitchen, your mom on the couch. Explosion on the TV, the bottles clatter.
Arda, out, quickly, out of the house, everyone!
She grabs.
What's wrong?
Your sister in the door in front of her room looking at you both. You look at your mother at the burning car on the TV, you look at your sister at the car on TV, and then at your mother.
You're really fucking nuts, Mom.
I'm really fucked. Earthquake.
Wait. Home, bag, couch. Explosion, clap. Your mother.
Out, out!
Your sister.
What's wrong?
The TV.
You're really fucking nuts, Mom.
I really thought an earthquake.
When will you finally stop with this shit?
I need my cigarettes.
I don't know.
You stole my cigarettes again?
I didn't steal your fucking cigarettes.
Get a job, you buy your own if you really want to.
I don't have your fucking cigarettes.
Your mother runs into the kitchen. No, to the toilet. She runs to the toilet and vomits because
she just ate something bad.
Then she goes into your sister's room and comes out with a pack of candy.
Little piece of shit. What's this?
They're mine.
What did you buy them with?
My own money.
They'll give you cancer.
At least they don't make me think the house is collapsing.
When you were 16, you could do whatever you want.
Oh, go fuck yourself.
She goes to your sister and you say something. You say, you're hungry. That always helps. You say that you weren't at Serkan Amca's today in the Mevlana Grill, where you chill with Savas after school, where you do your homework. You weren't there today because you were afraid to go, because Uncle Serkan always shouts too much, because Merve Teza is again is sick again, because they were closed today. Both of them look at you.
Come on, I'll make you something.
No, that's wrong. You say nothing. Not this time. Your mother comes back with a pack of candles.
You little piece of shit. How many times have I told you they'll give you cancer?
At least they don't make me think the house is collapsing.
Your mother gives her a bitch slap. You're 80, and you don't know what a bitch slap is yet.
Oh, go fuck yourself.
Your sister goes to the door. No. She goes to her room, throws some clothes in her East pack, and then she goes to the door.
Where are you going?
One day I'm gonna push you down the stairs.
You hear a voice in the stairwell.
Quiet out there! We're not in the bazaar here!
Your sister kisses you on the forehead and whispers,
I'm sorry.
Into your ear and slams the door behind her.
Shit. I really thought it was an earthquake.
You're 8. And you don't know what an earthquake is, or that Eileen will only come back long after she stops smoking. It's your 18th birthday. One for Goethe, one for Maxime, and one for your mother. It's your 18th birthday, and you swear, you are Arda Yilmaz, born on and swear under oath.
You never knew your father?
Yup.
Never spoke to him?
Yup.
Never found him, although you looked everywhere for him?
That is the most important lie of your life. Jackpot. Forget yesterday. You don't need a driver's license. Forget the over 18s club. You don't get in anyway. Forget the strong alcohol. You have better stuff. In your hand, damp the 318. It's your birthday, your 18th birthday, and everything's perfect. Just like you always imagined. Long hall, green tiles, glossy sunflowers. You stare at the picture. It got more faded. You think over the years, number 318 flashes. This is your 18th birthday. And you're really gonna party with Mr. Kosminski in the immigration office with a Polish accent. Kosminski explains all the papers you need to become a solid German. A family photo on the shelf behind him, also glossy. His son has probably bought stuff from you, you think. It's your day. One for Bismarck, one for Hitler, and one for your older sister.
Sworn declaration of unknown whereabouts of father.
Check.
Mother's residency permit.
In your face.
Mother's birth certificate.
Yes.
Your birth certificate.
Aha.
Proof from the consulate that you don't have Turkish citizenship.
Here you go, Almanya.
Wait.
What?
There's something missing.
You focus on the slow up and down bobbing of the head of the dog toy on his desk.
Just kidding, everything's fine. And now? The written language test. Small text down here, please.
You write.
I'll fuck your daughter till she speaks Arabic. I'll steal your son's internship, get him addicted to drugs, and sell his organs at the Turkish market. At night, I'll break the star off your Mercedes and wear it with my crescent moon chain. I don't want to be a doctor or a lawyer. I'm going to be a superstar or an employee. I am the German dream of wet German women.
Very funny, Mr. Yilmaz.
You put a little X beside.
I do not intend to change the democratic parliamentary system of the Federal Republic of Germany.
And sign with your dick there, there, and there.
Never lose this. There's no second chance under no circumstances.
Forget yesterday. You have better stuff now. And the boys are waiting outside.
And?
You show your certificate of naturalization, they show their naturalization present for you. It's your 18th birthday. One for Öziri, one for the scar under the eyebrow, and even one for your father.
Hello? Arda, hello? Shit. Not again. Where are you anyway? So, what I wanted to say was someone was here, and, you know, because of that thingy. We'll get the stuff back later, definitely, he said, but first he has to take it. He has to. He can't do anything about it, and yeah, from your room too. So basically you have to decide between the TV or the thingy.
The PlayStation, I told him the TV for now, because we still have one in the living room. You can play there now, but I wasn't sure. And he asked me what we bought it with. Can't remember at all, I said. You bought it yourself. You have a job. That's what I said, right? I couldn't remember anyway. You can still change the sticker, whether you prefer the TV or the PlayStation, depending. And what I... someone else I wanted to say. Ah, if your sister gets in touch with you, tell her things are really tight right now. Well, they always are, I know, but at the moment it is really tight. Tell her she's still gonna get her money this month, but...
You're sitting on your bench. You nod to a few people. Hi. Zdravo.
Fuck.
Two uniforms, all the way up there. Stay cool. You've hidden everything behind the trash can. You haven't done anything. They can't do anything, and you still feel bad. Well, Jan is beside you, small head, always up and down. He always jumps when there's a bus or a car beeps, brown hair, skinny arms. Suddenly, last summer, Bojan is sitting beside you. You think,
was he here yesterday?
You didn't notice.
He was here last week.
You didn't.
Last month he was here, right?
You didn't.
The dude's a chameleon.
You ask if he wants to buy some stuff. He looks at Pichu and he doesn't answer. You ask, what's up? He understands, but he doesn't answer. You ask if he's the son of a whore, if his mother is a dirty little whore who sells herself money.
Sometimes there's no other choice.
He says, and you get it, he's not the son of a whore, but...
I'm Bosnian, now I'm Croatian. Serbian, I'm Serbian. Whole family, Slovenian. Serbo-Croatian. You go Albanian.
And then he says,
whatever you want, doesn't matter.
Anyone who's whatever you want is definitely not one of us.
Hi, I'm Bojan.
Sure, man.
Doner kebab with everything.
The dude's a chameleon.
Two uniforms, all the way up there. They're coming. Bojan takes your smoke. He actually doesn't smoke.
Don't shoot!
He's a genius. He speaks four, five, maybe six languages. But not one word too many. All he ever says is,
keep your head down.
Three summers long.
What you doing, Bojan?
Keep your head down.
We're going to meet. Buy you some stuff?
Keep your head down.
Let's go to the media market. Play around with FIFA?
Keep your head down.
We're going to the drugstore, to the water dispenser.
Keep your head down.
Dude, what's the matter? Did they shit in your brains?
Just keep your head down, okay?
Boyan's mother's recipe for survival helps at every checkpoint. Even better than...
Keep your head down.
Is only...
Let's get out of here.
Two uniforms are coming. Past the Russians. Past the Gabas. Straight towards you.
Of course.
Hi, officer.
No suspicion, stop and search, boys.
You get searched. They grope in Danny's back pockets.
Right here, officer.
You show your certificate and grin, but you still don't have any ID.
So you apply for it.
Bojan has six passports.
He can use one of his, can't he, officer?
Negre, Neude, Nemo, Neide, not possible.
What do the two cops ask a Serbo-Croatian, Albanian, Bosnian from Slovenia?
Where do you come from? When did you come to Germany? Is your mother here?
In the station?
In Germany?
Yes.
And your father?
He keeps his head down.
And the other one?
Who?
The man who married your mother so you don't have to go back.
Bojan takes a deep drag of your cigarette.
Come with us, please.
3 weeks later, Bojan won't be sitting beside you anymore.
He'll be back.
And you think...
He was still here yesterday.
But you're not sure.
He was still here last week, right?
That dude's a chameleon.
You didn't notice, but marriage fraud is marriage fraud. And Yugoland is safe again.
Arda? Sorry you got cut off there. What did I want again? Oh yeah, she'll definitely get the children's allowance, and if she wants, I brought sadamas from Grandma. Maybe if she wants to come by, because I don't know where she is right now. Just for... half an hour. She doesn't have to, only if she wants to. Grandma would be so happy. They're really yummy. Or you could take some for her. You could do that too. But we can do that when you get here, right? And there's still drinks in the cellar. When you come, bring them up with you. Fine. See you later.
Get your stuff out of the bin. Up Bismarck Street, the joint is burning in Danny's hand. The last drags, he takes them. The wrong way round is in his mouth, and gives you a kiss.
From Marie and Johanna.
The best shotgun of your life. You have to watch out you don't fall over, and then you split the spliff away, and it's off to Melvana Grill. Munchies. Turquoise tiles, white tablecloths, a yellow sign over the door, gel gel, no usran, all yine gel. Said Kanamcha behind the counter, red hot sauce on his huge hands, Turkish engineering degrees framed on the wall. You look up at your naturalization certificate and back up at the degrees, and in that second, you understand that those engineering degrees are hanging there because they're worth nothing. It's your 18th birthday, and you're thinking of the past, of graduating school, when the doner kebab shop and the grease stains on exercise books, and a whole afternoon stirring mayonnaise in buckets in the garage out back, of football in the courtyard, of kids' birthdays mixed with grill plates, of Merve, Sava's mother, who you were secretly in love with, because she puts her healing hand over your ears while Uncle Sefkan shouts at her, because if her hands never smell of grease, but of earth. And you think of Merve's eyes, green like olives, behind swollen skin, purple like plums, and of red sauce again, and of Serkan Amka's huge hands. Two men come through the door, two men with guns. Come through the door and pull their guns, and you scream,
Watch out!
Too late, Serkan Amka's apron turns red.
Dude, are you completely baked?
Sabas gives you a bitch slap.
Get yourself together, man. We're dead if he notices.
Wait. Again. Two men come through the door with guns and uniforms and pull their wallets out of their back pockets. Serkan Amka wipes his hands on his apron and shakes theirs.
Officer, I've been seeing you for ages. Two men, everything. Hot sauce.
Medved leaves the room, so the uniforms stop making eyes at her. It's your 18th birthday, and there are mixed grill plates for you and your boys, and no one knows that the police will be back in 2 months and that the Mevlana Grill will be closed forever because something's dripping in the garage out back.
Can you hear it?
It's dripping. It's dripping red into the mayonnaise. It's dripping from slashed arms full of hot sauce.
There!
From fingertips.
Can you hear it?
That smell like the earth, from slippers hanging in the air. It's dripping.
There it is again!
It's your 18th birthday, and you look into Salas's eyes. Stoned eyes. No sign that his father will take down the degrees to take them back to Karaman. That Sabas will go back with him, and that Merve will not. Because all of you in this world, all of you are just stupid fucking guest workers. You're chilling. You're chilling on your bench because,
brother, you know, the revolution will not be televised.
Are you up for it?
No way you're gonna miss that. So you chill on your bench, 4, 5, you already know, for like 6 summers now. And you know, you sense it's gonna happen today. Tonight, the whole station will be dancing till sunset. Everyone's there, you know that guy, you know that guy, and him, and him, and him.
A to the R to the D to the A.
Revolution superstar. The gabas from further up congratulate you and give you a pit bull puppy with a red bow with tears in their eyes.
Our youngest is free.
And you give them your chain. And the dogs sing and the pigeons fuck, and you, hand in hand, march on the spot. Shuffle to the right, shake your heads. Shuffle to the left, march on the spot. Shake your heads, as if it was the last one. The refugees from further down, Russians, Kazakhs, Uzbeks, Polaks, handing out rounds for everyone in the field.
Vodka for everyone!
and perestroika inside you. So you chill on your bench because...
Brother, you know.
The revolution will not be televised.
Not from the Mevlana and not in school, but only here. Here on this street, and that's where your liberation is. And you're up for it. Boyan tears a page out of one of his passports and rolls a joint.
Only sky's the limit.
Takes a drag and passes it to two policemen. Susanna and Danny are sitting beside you. On his shoulders, this little Roberto drooling and puking, his baby face covered in red and white glitter.
Because the shizzle just got fed.
Your mom calls.
When are you coming?
Eileen and her are waiting, dinner and stuff. At the bench, on the very end, Merve and Serkan kissing like they were 17, and it smells like fizet. And you chill. You chill on your bench one final summer long because you believe.
The revolution will not be televised.
But something's not right. And you realize no one's there. You realize you're alone. You realize you're 18, and your friends are dying. In the papers, with black bars covering their eyes. In the parks, on the benches, in TV shows, as numbers, and in the statistics, your people are dying. A generation on street corners begging for an eternal youth. You're 18 and you get it. You lost. And you scratch into the bench with your key.
A to the R to the D to the A.
And
A to the L to the M to the Anya.
So that you never forget where you came from. Imagine you're lying in your grave. Dead. Don't know how, let's just say. You're dead. Because a nationalist offer took revenge for his granddad who rode the wrong bus at the wrong time. Or because a young revolutionary climbs into the bedroom of your house one night with a gun. Because you betrayed the ideology of the left after you left prison. Maybe you just choke on a grape. And your frustrated wife, your second wife, watches you slowly choke as she smokes. Or imagine you're dead because you were drooling and demented. How old are you? 70? You couldn't understand the graffiti in the streets of Galata anymore. Couldn't understand the world being tweeted from Gezi Park. Couldn't understand the people in the streets of Ankara on tanks, in prisons, leaving the country. And you make your final exit, quiet and uncomprehending, in your bed on the Aegean. So imagine, you're dead, doesn't matter how, because one day it'll happen. Would I know? Would someone tell me? I didn't even know you were alive the last 18 years. The opposite. I had to swear that you'd been kidnapped, that no one knew who you were. I traded your life for my citizenship. I'd probably find out somehow. I mean, that you're dead because of my half-brother. His name's Osgood, right? Because he photoshops your face beside Atatürk's, slightly transparent onto the Turkish flag, and posted on Facebook. And now I'm here at your funeral in Konya, uninvited, in, let's say, a white linen suit. And with me, I bring your heirs. My mother, my sister, and me, 18 and stateless because I'm a terrorist kid related to your revolution. And then that one asshole that no one should mess with, the immigration office. I'll also bring social workers who told our teachers we had no perspective, but we had too much perspective. We saw things other kids should never see their whole lives as they eat their parents' pumpkin soup. I'll also bring Sabas, blood brother. Twins joined at the head, my best friend, your best friend, Seb. All the others who disappeared gradually, one by one, without throwing a single stone. The guys from the asylum seekers, home across the road too, they call me the son of a dog every day on my way to school, and I agree. Merve, Saba's mother, wouldn't be there. Tell her I said hi. And I'll bring your mustachio friends who pat me on the back at Turkish weddings, who tell me I look so much like you, who tell me that one day I'll be like you, the son, the hero of a revolution. Okay. What's all this about? About a guy who runs away from Germany and then back again?
So what? Forget it!
It's about him going to prison for 17 years voluntarily?
Forget it!
It's about her and about him. About him and about her. About real, true love. All that stuff, but it's not that simple. Let's go. In the year of the Lords of the Guesswork and the Cold War.
New Year's Eve, 81-82.
He.
Hello, I'm a bar. His first New Year's in Germany. Fucking freezing.
So cold.
She.
Not even 20. First time out, at night with the girls. Lipstick in the rearview mirror, shouting, woo! Loudly.
Teenage dirtbag, life is great.
He.
Waited, especially until all the others were finished. Waited until all the people, really everyone in the home, had gone to the bathroom, so he could shave in peace. Sideburns, chin, the whole shebang. He's still got a few cologne samples in his jacket pocket. He uses them now. But don't mix them all and keep a bit for later. He, freshly showered, iron shirt, smoothly shaven, doesn't want to be taken for a terrorist right off. Don't conform to the cliche.
Don't conform to the cliche. Don't do it.
Looks great anyway. In her Ford Fiesta, her and her girlfriend. Girlfriends, Nolan, Chanan, Aydan, and Aishan, and Merve. She's there too. Conversations about Rosa Luxemburg's hairstyle, suitcase child trauma, and white boys' asses. Into the women's car park, and into the bar.
He
knows. Whatever happens, don't dance. Don't start them, Haley. Don't twirl a white handkerchief. Better off not even looking at the dance floor. Because that just looks like when you're standing in front of the meat section in the supermarket with your food stamps. So instead, he blabbers on at the dreadlock barkeeper. Why? Because you look like a total psycho hanging around a bar on your own. Until
she
walks through the door.
Hey, baby.
A murmur goes through the bar. Believe me, I've seen photos of my mom. She looked amazing. She looks. He looks. She looks again. He sees that she looks again. She looks away quickly, and straight away he feels that's his girl. That's the love of his life. And it's her or a suicide attack.
Hey, baby.
She
actually only looked because she's short-sighted, but is much too vain to wear her glasses tonight.
He
has already learned. That doesn't mean anything yet. Looking over means absolutely nothing at all. Even if she was sipping on a damn straw at the same time, stay cool. Women in the West and so on.
In the West and so on.
She.
Up to the bar. A drink first.
Knows he has the following options. One, she's German. A German woman will give you a proper handshake with a vacant smile and talk to you for hours before her work, about her work, about her asshole boss, about her sister's career, and so on. You nod every now and again, and even if you don't understand a word, you're understanding, funny, cheesy. And if it goes well, you use the icebreaker. You look right at her chest, briefly, really only very briefly, a millisecond. And then look deeply back into her eyes straight away. As if it was an accident. As if you didn't mean to do it. As if you just couldn't help it. Because she's so incredibly hot. And you're an Anatolian monkey, completely controlled by your instincts.
I love Anatolian monkeys in bed.
Hey, if a German woman drinks an alcoholic drink, beer, then she's working class. Summer jobs, public transport to school, or wine. Then, the child of employers. Probably guest worker employers, a pool in the garden, but parents are never there. B, if she's German and has a non-alcoholic drink,
forget it.
Much too stressful for one night.
even New Year's Eve.
Two,
she's Turkish.
A Turkish woman,
kiss on the left,
kiss on the right,
will tell you how much she hates the Turks in Germany because they're always shouting. The way they all have accents, which is why people always tell her how good her German is. But that, she still loves her mother's summers, correct her alamnic, so she knows you're not a koi kablostisi, not a guest worker either. You're an engineer from Konya. By the way, with her, definitely don't do the looking at the chest number. Hey, if a Turkish woman has a non-alcoholic drink, then you say,
you need some lemon in your drink.
Doesn't matter what she's drinking. Turkish women just love lemon. And you say,
that trick is from your big abla.
Doesn't matter if it's true. Turkish women just love guys with big ablas. B, last option, she's Turkish but drinks an alcoholic drink. Then,
jackpot!
She
goes to the bar and orders the first vodka and lemon of her life.
Jackpot!
He.
Okay. Go and talk to her.
But don't screw it up. He knows. There's only one golden rule.
If you fuck up the opener, you fuck up the opener.
Bets everything on one card. He goes over to her, looks deep into her eyes, and slams down four marks, 50 and 5 pence coins on the bar in front of the dreadlock guy. His entire month's savings. For her vodka lemon, as if he was announcing, girl. Get in. I'll take you to the moon.
Girl, we'll take you to the moon. Girl, to the moon. Girl, to the moon.
Huh? Mm-hmm. What's that supposed to be?
So what? Forget it.
He. Kusura bakma. Almanya seni.
She answers in Turkish, too.
Buna şimdi.
But for our fellow citizens with a migration deficit, what's that supposed to be? She.
Turns around to go right away.
And now comes that one moment, inexplicable, a little bit too kitschy, but essential for every good story.
Holds her back by the arm and tells her everything, the whole story, that he started a student movement called Devrimci Sol, Dev Sol for short.
For the members of the audience not so talented at languages, the revolutionary left.
That, actually, all they did was whistle after girls. But then there was actually a few attacks, nothing crazy. He says, a bomb in a political party, a little shooting, a bus stop and stuff. There was a crazy drive, and yes, actually, a few people died. Not loads, maybe four. But there was a civil war going on, geopolitical interests. She must have learned about it, the civil war, the Cold War and stuff.
So cold.
And ideologies are still at a premium. Human lives are cheap. And anyway, he wanted to overthrow the government, the Turkish government, the Turkish dictatorship, and replace them with more than just Turkish left-wing dictatorship.
But
had to jump out of the shower one morning when he heard on the radio,
the army has seized power for the welfare and the unity of the country.
Had to drop everything, pack his backpack, and was gone. Because since the coup last year,
curfew, tanks in the streets, messy business.
So messy.
Just no chance of a fair trial. And since then, he's been waiting here in this bar, all alone, for his trial. His trial that will decide if he can stay in Germany.
He never says asylum case procedure. Asylum sounds like people who aren't worth anything. Trial sounds like power. Literature and suits.
And he's been waiting a real damn long time. And today, he was very close to just drinking himself to death in this cold fucking country. With these cold fucking people. And this stupid 68 student movement. Hippie bartender. If only he had the money.
Until she walked through the door.
And now there's this heat in his lungs, this wobbly feeling in his thighs. Because in that moment when she looked at him, his whole life that led him to this shitty dive bar suddenly makes sense again. Because now he suddenly feels like a schoolboy, taking a detour home just so he could see his childhood sweetheart around the next corner. Because for the first time since he fled Turkey, he felt like a human being again. Say something, please.
So she's standing there, listening to all this. Let's remind ourselves, not even 20. Slightly perplexed, in front of a guy telling her with the disarming honesty only murderers have, telling her that he's a terrorist, a hunted enemy of the state in Turkey, illegal in Germany, buying her the first vodka lemon of her life.
And she says,
translating that would take too long right now, but it's clear what's going on, right?
And this vodka, her first ever, tastes so damn good. And while this guy is standing there in front of her like that, she thinks, mother, who would give her a slap right now, because she didn't come to fucking Germany so that her daughter could hang around with some criminal in some filthy dive bar. So she looks at him, puts her hands on his head, which is a little too large, and kisses him as if they were deporting him tomorrow.
What?
So while his comrades are playing Elie Bir and getting their balls electrocuted in a high security Turkish prison on New Year's Eve, he's smoking his first cigarette after sex in Germany.
So Umi's in love, from the top of her curls to her painted nails. So what? But something's not right about this guy.
File number 1971-2-14-A1-B06-F-04-I-00-T-03-N-02-S-640-RME-P-1413. Date, December 2nd, 1979.
We present the following evidence.
Due to membership of a terrorist organization, the state prosecution is investigating the following person. Firstly, name and age of the accused.
His name?
Mr. Murat Yilmaz.
Actually, Mehmet Murat Yilmaz.
Born in.
And his baba?
Mr. Mustafa Yilmaz, officer with the Havakubadir.
What an asshole. Before the sun.
And then here's Dede.
Mr. Murat Yilmaz, soldier in the Third Army of the Last Sultan.
I'm named after him. Asshole, too.
What the hell?
Imagine dinner at home with the Yilmaz, manti with yogurt, above the dining table, a picture on the wall, Mustafa Kemal shaking Murat Dede's hand, and his father tells little Murat what his father told him. Something about the Turkish War of Liberation. Okay. Murat would really like to ask,
which of these three was actually responsible for the Kurds, for the Greeks, for the Armenians?
But he doesn't ask.
For my mother's sake.
Then at 18.
Baba, I'm not joining the army. But
since then, my old man doesn't look me in the eyes anymore when he's talking.
So, studied in Konya.
Konya!
With his best friend, Serkan.
Serkan!
40 square meter apartment, loads of frozen borek, getting stoned all day. Both of them get goose pimples about fast cars and mechanical engineering degrees on the side.
Little side facts.
The first Turkish car model was called a Devrim.
In German, revolution.
At its first lap of honor at the parade in 1961, with President Gürsel at the wheel, the car stopped moving after a few meters, and then he died.
So what?
People can't make any progress in this country. And until then, our brains will all stay provincial.
Secondly, the psychological development and maturity of the accused.
When he was still a student, membership in an activist group.
Wake up, damned of this earth.
Is that an accusation? That already counts as terror?
Actually, they were only involved in the group because of women. Second side fact.
Remember, boys, left-wing students jump into bed with you much quicker than their conservative fellow students.
They read Karl Marx. Start of sentences. Argue about which make of car will survive after the communist revolution, and whether Mao, Che, or Lenin had the biggest balls.
Oh, what a question. Everyone knows.
Lenin for life.
In the reading group, The name Mahir Cheyenne is also mentioned for the first time.
Have you ever heard that name, Mr. Yilmaz?
Of course he's heard that name. Mahir Yilmaz.
Robbed a bank in 71, and then handed out the gold to the poor in the Gasekondas. Mahir Yilmaz.
Carried out numerous robberies and kidnappings. In the last one, in Kizilderi on a mountain, 4 NATO radar technicians were killed, 9 other terrorists were killed.
Guerrillas.
4 NATO radar technicians, 9 other guerrillas, and he himself.
You don't die in Kizilderi. In Kizilderi, you live forever.
You admit to admiring the actions of a criminal?
Say, I can understand why some people lose it and can't just sit on a bench and watch.
You organize demonstrations.
Which the police disperse.
His father doesn't even want to talk to him on the phone. He tells his mom he has nothing to do with it. But then the chicks from the reading group look over. He shouts the loudest.
Hey, Devrimchi! Hey, ya, Direnish!
You distributed illegal pamphlets.
Because they banned our magazine.
You occupied the university.
Because they arrested our professor.
You threw stones at shop windows, ATMs, at buses and cars.
Not true. Never at cars. We never threw them at cars. What's all this about? About this? Stones? Is that the accusation?
Thirdly, the accused flee.
Well, look out there. Our people are dying. On the dry fields in the Gasekondas, on the outskirts of the city, in the torture basins. Under corrupt judges, they're dying everywhere. In Ataturk's faces, on the flags, and on lira banknotes, in the crying screams of Kurdish children on Taksim Square, in 77, during Bloody May. They lock everything up and everyone up. Students, journalists, teachers, doesn't matter. Our comrades devoured by the gray wolves, kidnapped and held captive by their own government. Drowned in the NATO's blue, drowned off the coast of Cyprus. Drowned in dirty old wars. Our people are dying, you're going on about stones.
Are you with me? Time for Umi's backstory. Smyrna in my head. Every water, I see every sunshine.
Every sunshine.
Smyrna, in my legs, with every single love.
Every single love.
Just for you, Murat. Umi, please.
Mom is washing my back. First my arms and my shoulders, then my calves. Suddenly we hear a glass smash, but very short, not long. Mom looks up and then back down, and then water in the bath is making waves. Dad, in uniform, black and white, pushes himself along the edge of the shelf and jumps down onto the foamy tiles. And then glass smashing all over again. And Mom pulls me by the hair. Out! Get out of the house! My eyes are burning. I step on Dad's face, and we run. Out! Out of the house! Onto the big square in the sun.
Smyrna.
Smyrna!
You feel that, Murat? That's Smyrna.
Smyrna!
In my dreams, with every cup of chai, every shower.
In my dreams.
Smyrna in our sentences, with every song, every step.
Every step.
All our neighbors are on the square too. The boy from across the road right at the front, holding his mother's hand. He turns around and looks and smiles at me. And I smile back, like last night when we were playing in secret. My legs feel wobbly, because the ground is wobbling. And the boy is smiling. And suddenly, the earth opens up, and one house after another, including ours, collapses into dust in the sun.
And this earthquake was Almanya.
Almanya!
The land across the great sea. The land of zombies. Everyone says they have no arms and no legs there because of the war. That's why they need people. They say, you have money for a new house there. But, Mom, don't go to the zombies. Mommy, we don't need a new house. Mommy, what am I supposed to do with the neighbors? Mommy, stay with me. Mom, stay in Smyrna forever.
Smyrna.
Smyrna.
I say Smyrna.
Smyrna,
my eyes, with every name, every tear.
Every name, every tear.
Smyrna in my legs, my only love.
My only love.
You still there? Has everyone got enough drinks in their hands now? And Smyrna in their blood? Okay, so Umi's mom goes back to Almanya. The plan, make money, new house, go back as soon as possible. And sure, we know that one, and our Umi will stay with the neighbors for
Smyrna.
Until she too, 5 summers later, 1 first love, and a childhood later, was standing all alone and motherless in the airport of the land of the zombies. Umi asks where her mom is, first in Greek, and then in Turkish. The woman just stares, puts a headscarf on Umi and falls silent, because suddenly she realizes that that's her mother. They hug, and they kiss, and they're happy. But really, Umi's legs are shaking because suddenly, in that moment, they both realize that the earthquake was Almanya. It tore through Smyrna. And because of it, and from then on, both of them know that they'll never really know each other again. And so...
Smyrna.
Smyrna!
Smyrna in my head.
In my head!
Smyrna.
My youth.
Every water I see.
Every sunshine.
Every water, every sunshine.
Smyrna
in our legs.
Our only love.
Our only love.
But the way things go,
we weren't finished yet. Fourth to the circumstances of the offense.
Cats in the city, you know how we're doing.
The limousine calls at night,
you know how we're doing. We fly into this tower, you know how we're doing. Entertain us, play with us, die for us, my dear, and we'll follow you.
Baba, I set off for war last night. Baba, these are my last words. I was a soldier last night and thought, who knows, maybe you're actually proud of me.
Sparkles on the water, you know how we're doing. The sun high in the sky, you know how we're doing. Black mushrooms in the sky, you know how we're doing. Entertain us, play with us, die for us, my dear, and we'll follow you.
We are 1,000. We walk through the streets, pamphlets into the air. Hammer and sickle on the flags, Sekan beside me, rage in his face. Stones in our hands, the police are waiting. Up there, on the big square, I go to throw, but suddenly, someone is holding my hand. Mustaches and turtlenecks, jeans over leather boots. Baba, I swear on my mother, he looked like Mahir. He said he had been watching us, and that he knew a few people. Didn't we want to take part in something real? I was still tightly holding onto the stone in my hand. But if they forbid everything, what will you do then?
Noise in the streets, you know how we're doing. Stink in the alleys, you know how we're doing. Cars as candles, you know how we're doing. Entertain us, play with us, die for us, my dear, and we'll follow you.
Me, on a corner street, keeping watch for birds that might snitch on us. Me, been on lookout 4 or 5, maybe already 6 hours, across the street. Serkan in a blue Ford Escort, stolen last week. The only light, a street lamp. 2 men coming along the street, we never wear masks, always just mustaches and turtlenecks. They go to the shop across the street, the party office of the powerful. They use a screwdriver to open the glass door and disappear inside. No screams, no shits. We wait 4, 5, maybe 6 minutes. But then Serkan gets out of the blue Ford Escort and he looks at me as if to say, let's get out of here, right now. I look back as if to say, Rock, pull yourself together. A second look, I'm getting out of here. Come with me. I look back, no. We're finishing the job together. The glass door flies open. Serkan runs away. I go to the escape car. The 2 men with mustaches and turtlenecks run out of the building. I'm behind the wheel. But suddenly I see there's no key in the ignition. And the two men get in the car. I know only 4, 5, maybe 6 minutes until the fireworks. I briefly close,
the car, briefly, quickly stick one of our stickers onto the lamppost.
My hair was here.
We need a bigger audience, and then I drive away, calmly but fast.
The moon above the roof, you know how we're doing. Not a soul in the park, you know how we're doing. Outlines on the ground, you know how we're doing. Entertain us, play with us, die for us, my dear, and we'll follow you.
Then they said they were going to steal a bus for a special mission. They already know that I know how to steal cars. They said it would only be very simple. I say, I'm not sure. But Baba, once you're in, what do you do then? Here's an eyewitness report.
Fifth witness statement.
Blue Ford Escort stops close to a military bus station. Two men and two women get out and take position behind the car. Another car, model unknown, parks around 30 meters away. After 2 hours, a military bus driver drives into the station. When the driver gets out and goes to the trunk, the two men, short hair, mustaches, sweaters and jeans, and two women, long brown hair, one with sunglasses, come out with an AK-47. One of them orders the four officers to get out of the bus. When the first comes out of the bus with his hands in the air, the driver suddenly runs away. One of the women, this one with the sunglasses, opens fire. She hits the driver in the back, he drops. She runs over to him, three shots at short range. A retired Turkish army officer who lives nearby witnesses what happened. He runs onto his balcony with a shotgun, shoots the woman. The three officers run off too and are shot by the men. The woman, without glasses, fires at the balcony. The men carry the wounded woman to the Blue Ford Escort, where there's this young man, younger than the others, sitting at the wheel. They drive away.
17 years imprisoned, Baba. It's demanded by the state attorney. I wanted to go to the police. I could have said I didn't know anything about the plan. Could have said I was only the driver, and if I turned myself in. But then, when the junta seized power in the morning, Baba, they brought Serkan into the hall at night. Just because he was a member of our association. They blindfolded him, gave him cold showers, beat him with sticks, electrocuted his hands and his groin, tied him to a plank, hung him from the ceiling, waited and asked, where was his friend hiding? Where did he get the guns? How did he help me? They said they could do whatever they wanted with him. They could throw him out the window and say it was a suicide. They could shoot him and say he was trying to escape. And when they find you, they'll put you on a stool with a noose around your neck. And if you want, you can say one more thing. Some shout, down with the dictatorship! Most say nothing. They check the noose again, aim their guns at you, and order you to kick the stool you're standing on out from under you yourself before the blood shoots into your eyes. Terror needs an audience. So do executions. They send you the video. Baba, kiss Anne from me. I'll be in touch again from Russia, Cuba, or China.
The wind is warm. You know how we're doing.
Seagulls fly low. You know how we're doing. The water flows quietly. You know how we're doing. Entertain us. Play with us. Die for us, my dear. And we'll follow you.
Okay, I heard that there was a wedding here today.
Yeah!
Did I hear someone say yeah?
Yeah!
Effendi?
Yeah!
I can't hear you?
Yeah!
Okay, the happy couple onto the dance floor, please. And you, where are you, people? Get out your lighters and men, dry off your sweaty hands and take your darlings by the hand and get closer at their knees.
Yeah!
Now men, this is the moment you have to apologize to all your chanlars for all the nights you never came home. For all the arguments about household money, for tearful children's birthdays, for all the bar fights, the wars, the terrorist attacks, the genocides. Single ladies, if you're there, close one eye, get on the dance floor. Let's go!
Let us tell you about...
She.
Who will probably never be as carefree as today.
And he.
Who will never again have residency issues from today.
She.
Who visits him every day for 3 weeks in his room in the home, which only consists of one bed, to translate his 132-page charges file, word forward.
And he,
who can't stop kissing her in the thigh as she does.
Yeah!
Okay, it's coming, folks.
Let us tell you about...
She...
who somehow feels that the second little line means a girl.
He,
who's going to slaughter three lambs, if it's a boy anyway.
She,
who thinks Eileen is a lovely name.
Oh, yeah. Who else is there?
He, whose father came especially from Konya to smuggle the papers to prove his son is unmarried in Germany.
And she,
whose mother didn't turn up for the wedding.
Mom and Dad, come on, a little bit closer for me. She,
whose mom says she is much too young, too naive, and too stupid for men, marriage, and children. He's only after her passport anyway.
Blah, 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 blah. So what? For Umi, anyways, this marriage means getting away from home, at least. Away from her mother, with Smirna in her head. She slammed the door and was gone.
Let us tell you about...
He, who can finally work, and already has a job offer.
Yes. 14 hours at the production line of a slaughterhouse.
Yes, but doesn't matter, because he's learning German.
Sure.
He
is going to finish his engineering degree.
Definitely.
Has a family now, a little flat, and his first one. Non-stolen Ford Fiesta, which he usually drives his family to the lake with, and eats a shishak sandwich there.
What more do you want?
She
is going to finish training as a secretary, and then smoke Havanas in Cuba. Then make out in the streets of Bangkok.
With a baby?
Why not? With a baby.
But before she goes to Cuba, the little one goes to the park behind the bum field first. Breathe, people. Don't forget to breathe. Are you still there?
Yeah!
What? I said I can't hear you.
Yeah!
Okay, now we're gonna take it down. Come on, take it down. Just the hips. Very slowly. Oh, yeah. Back and forth. Just like that. Hips against hips. Oh, mama. Back and forth. Come on, people. No false modesties. You know how it ends. We're staying down, okay? Where are the groomsmen and the bridesmaids?
Second, at the buffet.
Merve with her family at the table.
Bye, bye, bye. They don't know each other. But a short Turkish, let me be your kaimak player look from Serkan is enough. Merve excuses herself briefly from her family, and the two of them kiss on the left, kiss on the right. Menem Oldum, me too, disappear to the back of Umi's not-stolen Ford Fiesta faster than the happy couple can say.
Yeah!
Danny is proud of you.
Serkan builds car doors in Konya and actually wants to stay there.
But Merve doesn't know anything about car doors and just can't handle 35 degrees Celsius in the shade.
So Serkan comes to Germany for her.
And they open a 5-star restaurant for Anatolian specialties, okay, named after his hometown.
All right, we're about to go back up again. And when we're up, I want you to shake everything, really everything out, okay?
Yeah!
We're going up for a dance. Dance after all this shit. Dance for a few life goals at last. Dance for a job, for a car, for a wife, for a child. Dance for what can happen to you now. Dance for freedom, Umi. Dance for your new life, Murat. For your second life in which all will be well and nothing can happen. Dance the night away. Dance away the coup. Dance away the revolution. Dance away your passport. Dance away your parents. Dance away your youth. Dance away Almanya. Dance away the cold. Dance away the war. Oh, baby, dance, 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 dance! Okay, thanks a lot, folks. That was enough dancing for me. Well, you know how it ends. Thanks, Mom and Dad. That's all for now. Good night.
I ain't got no home.
She has no gold, has no silver, has no perfume, has no clothes. Allah, her soul really knows no wrong. We ask you, understand her right, because...
I often get dizzy. I haven't been feeling well the last few mornings. And Allah, if I'm ever in happy circumstances, then I'll always, always be grateful. But right now, I think I want to be unhappy. I got a car from Nolan yesterday, the Eiffel Tower at night. She started university. She's doing well and asks how I am, of course. She says I should visit her and I really like to.
But Allah, she has no money, has no rent, has no friends, has no dreams. Allah, her soul really knows no wrong. She knows all that's not important compared to life, but if she were ever in happy circumstances, then she will always be grateful for another child. But right now...
Just now, my boss told me I can leave the kitchen soon. I'll get 4 marks more at the counter. And I think I can do it. I know I can do it. If I work hard and I am good to my boss, we just can't manage a second child right now. Allah, maybe Mom's right. He works hard. It's not like that. 14 hours a day. He doesn't make enough. He isn't what he studied here.
Allah. She has no free time, has no sleep, has no aims, has no home.
Allah, her soul really knows no wrong, but...
I went to Mom's last month to see the little one. She's doing well, healthy and stuff. Eileen is staying with her just for a while until we've saved enough money, maybe a little flat, but, you know, don't get me wrong, she screams. The baby, when I take her in my arms, I drive 4 hours there and 4 hours back just to see my child one day a week. But when I take her, she starts to cry. She doesn't recognize her own mother.
Allah, she has no baby anymore, has no family, has no dignity, has no love.
Allah, her soul really knows no wrong.
I work and save and drive, and Eileen, she doesn't recognize her mother, and that...
We ask you, understand her right, because...
That disgusts me. And if I'm ever in happy circumstances, then I'll always, always be grateful. I think right now, I want to be unhappy.
You give up.
Cut through the neck.
And stop.
Hang it up.
You had a dream.
Open up the rectum.
My hair is still stuck.
Skin it.
In Kizildere, in that hut on the mountain.
Cut it open.
Surrounded by fascists.
Got it.
But he was a hostage himself and was calling for you.
Next one.
Breakfast with Umran in her 7th month.
Cut through the neck.
Always slices of cheese.
Hang it up.
Sausage.
Hang it up.
Grandma called yesterday.
Open up the rectum.
Eileen's first day at school.
Skin it.
You get up.
Cut it open.
Ignore the bills on the table.
Got it.
You walk to the station, take the bus to work. German rain on the window.
Next one.
If you're late, they say...
He's gonna get fired. Cut through the neck.
And if you have to go to the toilet a lot...
He's gonna get fired. Hang it up.
If you ask for a raise...
Open up the rectum.
For your first call, for your child, for a holiday...
He's gonna get fired. Cut it open.
At the pigs with yellow caps... Poles and Hungarians?
Got it.
At the turkeys with green caps, Romanians and Bulgarians?
Cut through the neck.
At the beef with red caps, Turks, the rest of the world and you?
Hang it up and break.
You get up.
Break.
A thermos flask of chai?
Break.
Sliced bread with sliced cheese?
Break.
And your book?
Break.
Welcome, Germany level 1 for losers.
Break.
Last week's pictures in the cow's blood.
Break.
How they're even selling stones.
Break.
How they stormed the supermarkets.
Break.
Last week, freedom won.
Break.
Last week, Mahir, your death was for nothing.
Break.
Last week, Deutschland did win in the end.
Break.
Last week, your youth was judged.
Break over. Cut through the neck.
Dark outside.
Hang it up.
Empty bus, German rain.
Open up the rectum.
You get into bed.
Skin it.
Your wife mumbles. Smell like dead meat.
Cut it open.
And goes back to sleep.
Got it.
You dream.
Cut through the neck.
My hair is still stuck.
Hang it up.
In Kizildere, that hut on the mountain.
Open up the rectum.
Surrounded by fascists.
Skin it.
But he's a hostage himself.
Cut it open.
He calls out for you.
Got it.
You wake up.
Cut through the neck.
You wake up drenched in sweat. You take a drink and notice.
Hang it up.
It smells funny. Like dead meat.
Open up the rectum.
You think it's the 4 officers.
Skin it.
But then you remember, that's you.
Cut it open and gut it.
You leave the bed where Umran is breathing beside you. You don't pack a bag and you don't leave a note. You take Eileen's picture out of the frame of the night table and put it in the inside pocket of your jacket. Leave the house, dark outside, German rain.
Okay, now drums. Yeah, bass. Are you with me? Okay. Okay, drums. Yeah, bass. Drums. Bass. bass, drums, bass. Speaking to you are the sons of the revolution, who are still waiting for books from social services in the first week of school. The daughters of those who led the coup, born in the German fall. The children of the persecuted, tortured, the hanged parents who celebrate their birthdays in government offices. The future enemies of Germany, doing their homework in the toilets of the asylum seekers' homes because it's the only quiet place there. Those who always get scared when the police is nearby, no matter what they've done. Who can't go back because they don't come from anywhere. Speaking to you are the lonely mothers who've had to save the world alone, without the failures who never came back from getting cigarettes and planting bombs, who keep their heads down at checkpoints, who keep meeting new assholes in rehab, who wait for their sons in the corridors of courthouses. Speaking to you are the wannabe Che Guevaras who wanted to make the world a better place, but who are stranded in kebab shops, in toilet factories, behind taxi steering wheels, and production lines, who heard the fall of the Berlin Wall on the radio and suddenly realized that they've lost. The bomb makers and the hostage takers, the into the crowd shooters and the over the pile drivers, the unimprovable losers of history. Run, Murat! Run, Murat! Run, Murat!
You ran. You stopped running for your second life, for driving a Ford Escort one more time, for a holiday again on the Black Sea, at last for your children, who will see you on TV. You run out of the house.
Run, Murat.
Down the street, across the field, behind the station.
Where the scar above the eyebrow is sitting since it's been out of prison.
Run to her, Murat. Talk to her, Murat. Ask her if the scar was worth it, Murat. Ask about if the Kurdish childhood in Germany, Murat.
Whether it's still active. Murat, the Kurdish childhood.
In Germany.
If it's been radicalized.
The Kurdish childhood.
In Germany.
Whether we have to assume something here.
In Germany.
You run up Bismarck Street to the Melvana Grill, where Serkan's waiting behind the counter to say goodbye.
Where police spot kebab murderers while eating kebabs.
Take a last taste of the mayor.
You further down Bismarck, past the immigration office where your case is still being processed.
Where Kuzminski is only deporting people now since his wife has been swallowing antidepressants because the Nazis from the east are arriving now.
Keep going, Murat. You keep running past the meat factory where the refugees 333 are working now. Keep running, get in the car, a blue Ford Escort, further. Mahir Shakan's ghost on the passenger seat, further the trunk full of slaughtered calves, and on through Yugoslavia.
Say hi to Bohan if you see him, dropping some beats on the street corner.
What do you want there, Murat? What the hell do you want at Yugoslavia? It doesn't exist anymore, Murat. So keep going, Murat.
Keep going to Istanbul, where four dead officers are lying to Smyrna, where there are cracks in the ground to kill Desiree, where you throw Mahir out all the way to Konya.
Yes, Dunyai.
And you want to fall. You want to fall. You want to finally fall to your knees.
Gor Konyai.
But you can't.
Gesunyai.
You can't do it.
Gor Konyai.
You can't stop your legs.
Gesunyai.
And you keep running.
Gor Konyai.
You just keep on running further.
Run, Murat. Run like his mother after the earthquake. Run like Uli into the McDonald's kitchen. Run like Ali. Run like us. Run like we ran, Murat. And then stop.
And then breathe. Here. Breathe. Calmly. Calm down. Quiet. Do you hear that? That's your youth, Murat. That's your youth and mine. The day will come when we will be heard. The day will come when we will be free. The day will come when we'll be needed. The day will come when we'll arrive. The day will come when we'll be heard. The day will come when we'll be free. The day will come when we'll be needed. The day will come when we'll get home.
So I go to the little podium. Your coffin is beside me. And I glance over you briefly. And I'm happy. Because you're not bald, so I won't inherit baldness. The younger people don't know. Who's that boy? The older ones start to realize, shit, that's his boy. A little blip, that's back now. Your old comrades recognize me? The bastard? Because I really do look like you? You wanted to slaughter 3 lambs when I was born, to thank Allah for a son. You went back to Turkey 2 months before that, and now I can't stand touch. You went back, although you knew, hey, they were waiting for you with handcuffs, and maybe I'd even say I can understand it. Really, what are 17 years in prison compared to life in exile? Compared to always being on the run, compared, who knows? Maybe I'll go somewhere to fight myself tomorrow against the Turks, against the West, against the Kurds, the Islamists, or the Communists, or the Germans. I don't care who it is. Maybe at the end I would ask you why you never called just once, a short call, just to say that you survived prison, to ask, how are we? But then I go up to your second wife, the freshly made widow in the hall. Reminds me of Anne, with her cigarette in the corner of her mouth, and I express my condolences.
So thank you. We're going to have a talk. You can sit, stay here. I know you will have to go shortly before 6, but Dimitri, maybe come over, and we just sit in front of them. She will have to go to another rehearsal or another play at 6 and leave here about 10 to 6. So maybe we start now. Is this on, yours?
Is this on?
Yeah, so tell us a bit about the journey of working and discovering the play.
The journey, well, it was a brief journey. I think we got the first half of the play translated a couple of weeks ago, and then the second half translated last week, and then cast it accordingly. But I think it was just really exciting to get to start to realize what the piece really was, because you know I kind of read plays a lot, and to actually start to realize, oh, it's set up like a tape, and there's a side A and a side B, and the side A is like this Kendrick Lamar and all this hip-hop work that I really like, and then the side B is Nina Simone and all these other people, and that also frames the temporal landscape as well. It was really exciting just to be exposed to that work, and it's also just a piece that I kept on saying in this very brief rehearsal process that, you know, if we were actually doing it, we'd do da 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 da. So that's the energy of this scene, so just do that with a stand in front of you and try to feel that. I think it's a really, really great piece, and I was just hoping that we'd do some sort of justice so it could be like heard in some way by an audience, because I think that it resonates very strongly to an American audience, and I think that the distance of it being specifically about Kurdish Germans, that can allow us to listen more carefully and hear something that's more about our, you know, immigration problem that we have here in a really impactful way, I hope. So that I didn't answer the question, but that's something.
So what was difficult to work with in that play? What do you feel would be different as if it were an American play dealing with some themes of migrations and changing identities or divided identities also? Could you sense something that's different from American play, or how it's structured, how it's done, or do you feel it's kind of a universal play that could have been written here in the U.S. or created?
I think the American playwrights who I like, this didn't seem very far from me. The structure. I mean, I don't know. I think that there are a lot of different types of plays. So I don't really know how to answer that question. Sorry. I think the references are, you know, the references. There are a lot of references that we just don't have the history of. And so, like the drama, you know, I sent a file with some dramaturgy ideas and things. And but there's only so much that we can do in a rehearsal period. So there's a lot of history there that I think is more known. I mean, there was a moment where like the gabas, the dancers. I have a video from YouTube of these guys, and I feel like that's a reference that is known in a culture that's not known here. So I kind of like, there was a moment where I was like, we should just put the video up of what that looks like so there's some sense of it, or actually do it, but we also didn't have the time for that. So so I think it's only the references, but I think that thematically, it makes sense. And for me, I actually was able to better understand, you know, this whole thing about immigrants here getting licenses. I mean, I was able to understand that what that means as far as stasis and mobility for a person living in this country more because we were working on this play at the same time that I've been listening to that type of conversation. Also didn't really answer the question, but
yeah. Questions are mostly not meant to be answered. Just, as Hannah Arendt says, thinking without banister, like hold on, so it's also the same as like talking without it. So it's like a banister you don't really need to move forward. So, of course, you were part of the work. Yeah.
So first of all, it's very, very, so you did a very great job because it's so tough, even us, and really, because Turkish people are the how to say, major minority in Germany with 3 to 4 million people. So we know a bit about the very, very highly complex history of Turkey, but even for us, we needed really to have workshops where we get to know these different coup d'etats and revolutions which happened there. It's super highly complicated because once there's some leftist generals who take over, then there's a right-wing dictator who takes over, then there's a brief period of democratic elections, then again something happens which is really super weird. And this just to get to know that and the complexity of that. Plus then the complexity between Turkish and Kurdish people, plus the complexity of Turkey being before that the Ottoman Empire, which was really big and a real empire and then collapsed after World War I and left a scattered Middle East and Southeastern Europe and was the... basically the collapse of this Ottoman Empire was then... like 70 years later, it led to the Yugoslavian wars. So it's really the most complicated parts of European history that you could get are combined there and kind of just in one sentence, which is so tough to follow. Plus that there are a lot of information about Germanish things. And especially which are connected to the 80s or early 90s. And this is really, really tough to hear, and it was really, even for us, very tough to work on the text, even though we had several weeks to work on that, and we needed to really get a restructure of it, to get it somehow that people could understand it and get it. We really put it upside down, and mainly I'm playing the Arda character, and basically the way we restructured it is that it's one huge long monologue of him, that you don't let the other people, the other perspective speak, but this is the kind of remembrance of something that we start, because this is a highly autobiographical piece by Necati Öziri, whose father actually was in Devrimci Sol, in this left-wing, leftist, radical left movement, fled to Germany, then went back. And this big question about a revolutionary who was a terrorist, and this is already so strange, because nowadays we think that terror just comes from, you know, religious groups or something. But these times in the 70s with the RAF in Germany, which were left terrorists.
The Bader-Meinhof gang.
Yeah, Bader-Meinhof gang. And also in Turkey. And then this whole question about a guy, this myth about your father coming briefly to Germany, get your mother pregnant, and then just leaving back and just going back there to go to prison, because he can't bear life in exile. And this was so strange, and so we tried to make it more about this personal conflict of a guy who is trying to retell his story, who is trying to say, you know, one day we'll meet when you're dead, and then I'll tell you the whole shit you put me through, and maybe I'll understand so much of what you did. Because me, myself, just sitting there and just wasting my time, it's so fucked up. And I want to do something with my life. Maybe I want to do the same thing you did. But the only thing I'm really pissed off about is that you never called to even say that you're all right. So this very, very complex situation then of a guy being born in Germany but constantly being treated as not being German, and having this father who is not there, and the necessity to lie about him and never to get to know him, and we tried then this whole second part is a reconstruction which he tries to play out in his memory. So and it goes terribly wrong. So while in the text it works out, for us it was always kind of this thing that me being the impersonation of Necati, of the writer, who has written the text to say, this is how my dad and my mom met, but he doesn't actually know. So then it was, okay, so now I stage a play of how they met, and it goes terribly, terribly wrong, because you cannot reconstruct, and reality and your background history is much more complex and much more fucked up. So this is a really tough, tough, tough thing to do, and a highly complex text, and this is also something which we would call the post-migrant theater.
Migrant theater. Yeah, really, thank you, and especially the translation process was much longer than we thought. The translator also translated two plays, so you got it late in your hand. But true, it is interesting to have such a complex, multi-layered collage of something cryptic almost,
a bit
Kabbalistically hidden, hermetically closed, but full of references. How was the reaction of the Berlin audience?
It was actually since we really molded the text into or tried to stage the text in a very, very different way, it was quite good, because it represented something which is far more so making it an evening about how memory works or how reconstruction of history works made it added another layer of perception, that it was not just the story, which would already have been enough for a German stage to stage a play about Turkish migrants and having it been played on the main stage, but also adding another layer of the complexity of how to reconstruct our own history and how fragile this whole process is. And since we got so many evenings in the Gorky where we also use our own biographies and try to make it as authentic as possible, here to add another layer of complexity and to say authenticity in the eye of, you know, your memory is very, very difficult, because everything we say and we try to narrate about ourselves is in the end kind of a lie and tries to be more beautiful than it was, and to have him like say a beautiful poem about of his mother who in the end is a drunk, Yeah, and about his father who then says yes, and they try to imprison me. This is why I need to flee. But this is something which the author tries to put in his father's mouth, whom he never met and whom he's angry at. So this the reaction was quite good, but it's also, even to see it, it's a tough evening for the audience, but it resonates especially highly with the Turkish audience, because they know these references even better, of course, than the German audience. And it's kind of, it reminded me also now to hear it of Juno Diaz, The Brief and Wondrous Life of Oscar Wao, I guess it's called like that.
Yes.
He tried to make it the kind of the same structure with the side notes and so on and so on and so on. So
the underlying curse of the son who actually then has to suffer or deal with the sins of the fathers and grandfathers.
Yes, and one more thing which adds another complex layer, because nowadays we are all used to this myth of, you know, poor people coming from other countries and coming to Europe or to the USA, so they're, you know, people who are just poorly educated. But here we have another migration story of revolutionary people, of Marxist people, of highly educated people who had to flee due to their beliefs. And this is something which is quite unique, so that so that there was actually a decline in their family, not, you know, a rise to money, but actually being somebody there, having to flee, and then have a decline in your wealth and in your status.
Yeah, being low class. Is this in repertoire still?
Yeah.
It is. So I know you were going to Berlin tomorrow.
I am, yes.
So maybe you're going to catch it. I know you have to catch your train, so you should go now again. Thank you for your work.
Thank you.
We looked it up, 6:10, you know, and 7th Avenue entrance, left side. So tell us a little bit more about the before you all leave. Maybe we should. Anybody wants to say something before you leave about the play?
I can say something really quickly. Yes. I mean, we only got the script for this a couple days ago, so seeing it was a super fast process of learning it. But I immediately connected to it. Thinking about the U.S. history of colonization and the U.S. history of having other peoples in our country who we render to a second-class citizenship. I'm Puerto Rican, so it was really, really easy for me to see a lot of parallels between the, like, in being American but not really being American. And it was just, this is one of those plays where it felt like the themes could be really transparent to an American audience, that it didn't feel like... That despite all of the references and the thing, the specifics, the tones and the themes feel really accessible, even from just the first read and from the first couple of reads.
That's so nice to hear. It's amazing.
Yeah, I'll say something. Yeah. All right, on to that. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us on this wonderful day. My only commentary on the play, I'm from Ghana. I just got my citizenship in this country. So being in acting and doing good work, I'm starting to realize that there are specific inherent similarities, regardless of race, color, gender, sex, that we all go through. So the idea of identity and nationalism and homeland or motherland is a very interesting topic that I like to explore in plays, and this is a great place to explore that in. What does that mean? Is that a subjective question? Are your answers subjective? What do you believe in? Because you grew up in this environment with these people or in these situations. So yeah, it's a very interesting understanding when we try to explain to people identity. Are we explaining, when someone says, who are you explaining who you are or where you come from so that they can identify you? Or are you explaining that so that you can identify yourself? And I think that was the question that I got. I think it's a very...
So it is a complex play. Since we are Pinwald Voice Festival, it is as close to literature or to kind of a, you know, a cinematic kind of novel or a stream of consciousness, but highly, highly orchestrated, composed, and put together like almost like a musical piece. So tell us a bit. I know we talked with the other plays also about it, but the way How was it created? Did Necati, did he sit in a room and he wrote it? Did you rehearse it? Did everybody brought something in, since it was so custom tailored from him? And again, I would like to point out, this is not some playwright who's been hired to write about someone else's. So he created in the ensemble something about his life, his work, and it was then put on with the ensemble in a very big theater for a Turkish audience, where in Berlin, till a long time ago, there was nothing for a Turkish audience. That's 3 to 4 million, a lot of them are in Berlin. They do pay taxes, they are part of the landscape, you hear them, see them, you go to the restaurants, but there was never anything you would really in depth identify or engage with the world, or something you would see about them, or kind of a fantasy, someone who you'd also, but it was never such a creation. So how did you do it? How did it really work? From in the rehearsal room, how was it written on a computer or it was, videotaped? What did you guys do?
It was written by Necati, and it was during a workshop phase, which he did also with other playwrights, and all of those plays actually then were published and done somewhere. So it was highly productive.
Gorky had a group of writers five guys.
Of writers, and every one of them has written a play about exile.
And they were all staged?
Some even in other cities, so not only at Gorky, but there was a Syrian playwright, there was a woman, a very, very talented woman, whose mother, who was born in an Iranian prison, which she realized much later, and she actually done a documentary movie now about that, also about this story, and won at the Berlinale, a highly prestigious prize. And she's written it, and Necati started to write this first part, this side A. And then the chiefs of the theater liked it and said, well, then write the side B. And then he's written the side B, also added this history of his father, and so he composed it the way this wonderful colleagues just read it. But when we tried to stage it, then we realized, oh, it's so tough because it has so little scenes in that. So and then if you start, and then all of a sudden there's a choir of people, or why does he say that now? And so Necati gave us the possibility, the author, of completely rearranging stuff.
What did you do on stage with it?
What we did on stage,
it looked like?
It looked like we have one like deserted kind of room, and there's just one guy basically sitting there, and everything else comes out of his mind. So we experimented a lot with movements which are like looped. So the same thing, like he reloops his own biography, the bodies on stage like move in loops, and then all of a sudden a scene kind of emerges from that, but just a small part of the scene, and then it goes fade again, or that he rewinds it again and says, okay, so this bitch slap from his sister to his mother, and then he's just saying, yeah, rewind that again, see it again, see it again. So having this Arda character of somebody who really also indulges in that, in this remembrance of his traumas or what he has seen. And then the second part, we try to do it like a shitty La La Land kind of musical, that he tries to stage it and say, okay, so I'm sorry, this whole thing went completely out of hand, and I don't want to be angry because this is actually a love story, so now we'll make it a love story. And then people try to come there and have like, but really like a deformed kind of musical, like a crippled musical, which doesn't work. And where when he tries to stage that and to say, so and now, and they look at each other, and the mother says, oh no, I'm sorry, I'm just looking because I don't have my glasses on, I'm too vain to put them on. And then he says, what the fuck, it doesn't matter, just stand there, just you know, get in touch with him, why? And constantly trying also, when the father is trying to speak, being like, so really that this act of creation, of creating a play, is actually the only chance of getting in touch with the father and of interviewing him and to say, well, who did come to this wedding? Who did come here? and having so we try to really have a you know scenic design for that, which is not in the play, but we try to make it with how we construct the play on stage, and that this is actually everything which he says to his own father, which is strange because his own father appears as a character on stage, but still to have him trying like, yeah, this is how I imagine it. This is how I imagine you to be. This is how I imagine how you met, because I just don't know.
So
and nobody told me.
The invisible father, almost like a Hamlet scene, you know, what do you do where
yes,
you are?
Yes.
And the staging of exile is in such a complex story. I think this is truly significant.
Yes.
Also for Germans who are kind of mostly used of stories that come out of the Holocaust or writers who had to leave. And but to say now also to see a representation in a complex manner, you know, of what they, as you said, a Turkish, you know, immigrant, but they might not even suspect such a complex backstory. So I think it was a fantastic addition to that experience. And in defense of Germany, people said there are so many problems here. They took over 1 million people from Syria. I think the U.S. took 2,000 or 3,000. Yes, of course there are problems. Of course there are things to deal with. But also because they did that. So I think the country won't get the respect perhaps for that, what it deserves, but I would like to mention that. We have time for one or two questions. We're a little bit over time. At 6:30 the next thing starts, but still I would like to ask if there are comments or, yeah. Can you take the mic because we are recording it.
Hi, how were the choral unison text sequences staged at the Gorky?
We took them completely out.
They were gone.
They were gone because we realized that they work on a table read, but then if you really start rehearsing because the difficult part and is that he's written a play which is basically meant to be heard and not seen.
So you spoke the words.
So I spoke it and I tried to make it that it's a personal thing of yeah, bam, nice, you see that, nice, and so on and so on. So this is what we tried to do then, because we thought, oh, this we then completely this is what we found, and we actually found it maybe 3 or 4 days before opening night, that with that it works. That it works if you have an emotional, you know, an emotional center with an emotional, yeah, overcoming his inner flaw of being angry at his father, and then through this scenic process being able to talk with them, and that this whole thing, this last thing, also what you heard, the text of the father when he says why he wants to do it, put it as a question by Arda. And to have this father-like figure on stage and to ask him, why the fuck did you leave? Why? Was it so you thought that you, so just answer me, but he doesn't answer. And then the father is left alone, and so it's kind of an inversion, so that the whole story told by Arda's perspective about the father is now in the father's head, imagining his son asking those questions. And so we thought that for the scene, it's much more, you know, it could be more emotionally touching for the audience to really have one single person telling that than a choir, which is artistically masterfully done, especially in German, where he really did a very rhythmical, highly rhythmical, very, very well composed text. But then when you put it on stage, you kind of feel, okay, so now you listen for like 30 minutes or 40 minutes of this text, but you don't feel anything.
So how long did you rehearse it as a choir before you cut it?
Quite long. I also tried to have this written, the rhythmical thing, for maybe 2, 3, 4 weeks, and then even other things which we, I mean, basically I had to push the director off stage like 10 minutes before the audience got in on opening night, and just to see, okay, just get the fuck down, I'll do something with that.
But
no, we really, really had to juggle it with that.
Another question, comment? Yeah.
I'm so glad to hear you speak, Dimitri, because this actually is the continuation of the play and the clarification. I found the choir to be quite distracting, so I'm glad to hear that was... I have a question about the audience, especially the German audience. what their response was. What, when they saw something that gave them an insight into maybe the Turkish experience or the other immigrant experiences?
Well, first of all, in general, it's very interesting to have not only with this play, but with many plays that people describe it sometimes that just getting robbed of your white privilege. So to hear stories you don't understand, to hear words you don't understand, and also like these beautiful words when he says migration deficit. So being in an audience but being treated not like, you know, Turkish people or Russian people have been treated by Germany, like to say, well, you know, you're kind of a bit stupid, you don't know how it works here.
It's but not made for you,
it's
right?
Not made, it's not for made for you, you're excluded, and the white audience being excluded. And of course, for the smarter audience, it has this interesting effect of, okay, now it's not about me, it's about somebody else. It's a perspective which doesn't refer to my perspective. And so some people describe it as a quite revealing effect of feeling powerless and feeling stupid, of not knowing history, of not knowing the perspective of another person. And some people don't get it, and they just say, I don't get it.
Someone said that last night, and I think it's an important comment. He said, when I go to the Gorky, as a white, whatever, but I'm in the minority. I don't fit in. Everybody is from somewhere, you're cross gender, LGBT, or whatever. I'm not. And it's the only time, say, it's a good thing, you know, but it's a theater where you realize there's a different world out there.
Yes, and some even react aggressive to that. So they say, why do you always need to, you know, about exile and about other, I mean, why don't you make a piece about German history? And it's, well, everybody else does it. Go to any other theater. But it's really sometimes very, very interesting how this being robbed of your privilege, of, you know, of your supremacy, gets people really, really pissed off. And then you can just, you know, try to, in a discussion, to point it another way and to say, well, now you see how those people who now have a stage felt their entire life of not being taken serious or of feeling inferior to a culture which is presented to them as, well, this is the leading culture, and if you don't get it, you're out.
Or the drama or the narrative is never connected to their experience or their life. One last comment or thought. Jim, over there.
This has been a really amazing 3 days, because I feel like I've just had this immersion in knowing so much more about the Gorky, even though I've been there in person a number of times. One thing that I'm trying to grapple with a little bit is, but I'm beginning to understand, is that the impetus for the shows and coming from a wide variety of cultures, is that primarily coming from the writer? And if that's so, what is the case with actors who are not of that culture, such as yourself playing the Turkish role? Is there any form of what in this country we're kind of bollocks about cultural appropriation and saying we should have that? Yeah.
Yes, of course. This is something which we deal with, and which we try to find forms with. If I'm playing the character but he's a Turkish character, and how can we do that I don't just speak stupid Turkish words, but that you try to find cynic solutions. For example, in this case, there was the scene when father and mother meet, and both are played by Turkish actors, but I'm not Turkish. So they start the scene in Turkish, and I'm kind of like translating it like DVD commentary. And then after some times just say, okay, I don't even speak Turkish, I'm sorry. So they are also gonna continue now in German. So that you have to be quite open about that, and that it's a very, very slippery slope with being authentic with some things and not crossing, and then really not crossing the line, but still being able to perform some different things. And I think you can go quite far with adapting to another, but not commit cultural appropriation. But so this is not so black and white that only, you know, only Germans should play Germans and only Turkish people should play Turkish people. Me as a Soviet Russian can play a Turkish guy, but you have to be very conscious about that and to communicate it with the audience, who is not stupid. And in other cases, it's really great if you have an Afro-German actor who just plays a white man's role, but just, you know, without any comment, which is then great to have this kind of, you know, reverse cultural appropriation, which has a good effect. So there is no black and white in that, but maybe more than 50 shades of gray.
Yeah, and I think the great thing is it's obvious, it's open, it's kind of a made part of the play. There's this theme, the differences, and even they are not all the answers, it's visible, what normally often is so invisible or ignored, as Broadway was the famous Aladdin movie, Aladdin musical, and not one performer, and nobody in the entire creative cast was part of the Arab American world. Yeah. So it would be interesting to see what would a Gorky ensemble do with the music and text from the Aladdin musical. I would love to see that. Again, thank you for coming. We are way over time. We have
thank
to
you very
get
much.
Out here right away within milliseconds. And thank you all.